السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm Dr. Wi'am Al-Sidawi, working as a neurologist at King Abdullah bin Abdul Aziz University Hospital. It is my pleasure to moderate this lecture today. Thank you for joining us tonight. And now allow me to introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. Heidi Al-Wasiya. She is an associated professor at King Abdul Aziz University and consultant neonatologist. Dr. Heidi also holds a master's degree in clinical epidemiology from University of Calgary, Canada. Also, Dr. Heidi, we would like to express our gratitude for your dedication and effort in benefiting everyone through this, your interesting lectures. And today we will learn how to criticize a study by critical appraisal. For our audience, if you have any questions, please post them in the chat and we will answer them immediately by Dr. Heidi. Now, Dr. Heidi, please, you can proceed with your lecture. يعطيك ألف عافية.
شكرا، الله يديكم العافية. Am I heard? Do you hear my voice?
واضحة دكتورة، yes.
شكرا. So
إلا.
thanks for the invitation again and again and again. It's a pleasure to be here presenting epidemiology and research. And today we reached to appraisal. We summarized what I know in three lectures. However, the العلم behind the epidemiology is يعني لا حصر له. But in a nutshell, we are trying to summarize the most important the things that we can use to read and understand clinical epidemiology. So today, after the two lectures we presented before, we'll try to consolidate what we've learned in the last two lectures into what we will talk about today, which is critical appraisal. Now, for critical appraisal again, what would be the objectives? I presented this slide before, and I'm going to present it again, is to learn the language. The research language can be learned, and we just need to learn the vocabulary, the way we speak, and by time, inshallah, without a master degree, you can learn the language. Again, this slide I presented before, learning the language can allow us to listen properly to whatever research is presented to us, allows us to understand, allows us to use it for talking to colleagues and patients, and writing, if you're interested in writing a research paper, and of course, reading, which is the base of what we're doing in these three lectures. So the date in this slide is not so new, but I didn't find something similar. So many countries, they spent million of dollars, reals, and everything in conducting research and sponsoring research. However, that's actually been presented and published. Only 30 to 50% of people receive the recommended care, and only 30 to 40% of patients do not get treatments, as evidence based tell us. So why is that? So before we go into why is that and the obstacles or barriers of us applying the most recent evidence, first of all, what is evidence-based healthcare? In the old days, it used to be called evidence-based medicine, right? If someone remember, it's called evidence-based medicine. Nowadays, it's called evidence-based healthcare. So why is that? So first of all, evidence-based healthcare. Now, this is number one slide of learning language. Some of the language here or vocabularies we did talk about before. So look at this carefully or listen to this carefully. So evidence-based healthcare takes place when decisions, so you have to come up with decisions that affect the care of patients. That's our aim, patient care. We learn to use what we learn in patient care. are taken with due weight. We're going to talk about what's due weight according to all valid relevant information. So why it's called healthcare and not medicine? Because everyone that play a role in patient care should use evidence-based, meaning not only doctors, nurses, RTs, pharmacists, physiotherapists, everyone has part in taking care of patients. They should apply the evidence-based healthcare in that area. So what is the meaning of decisions taking with due weight? Due weight meaning you are putting everything together. It's not only evidence, it's not only statistics, it's not only numbers. We have to put other factors. Like, for example, they said that this intervention worked better, but am I able to provide it? Do I have the money to provide it? Do I have the personnel to provide it? So that's the meaning of due weight. يعني نحط كل شيء ممكن يأثر في الحسبة. يعني it's not just numbers and statistics. According to all valid relevant information, do you guys remember what we said? What's the meaning of valid before as a vocabulary in epidemiology? Do any of you remember? I'll just give a less than a minute for you to answer. Here we go. We get some answers. Accurate, yes. So already Asma has answered. Yes, it's accurate. So valid is accurate. So who knows who's accurate? We said it before. No one knows what is the accurate answer. It's always there. We hope and we do our best to get what we're doing accurate. What we're doing in terms of research, I mean. And when we read, we have to decide how accurate is what we're reading. So valid is accurate, but in the research vocabulary. So that's evidence-based healthcare. So that's what we want to decide. So there's so many, what do I say? So there's so many factors or things to learn before deciding, is this valid enough to be used or to be applied for this patient. Okay, so again, this is not a new reference, but like, look at this, like, and this is actually very old, so I'm sure the numbers are more now. So a clinician needs to read 17 peer-reviewed article per day to stay current and up to date. Who can do that? 17 papers a day. I'm sure it's more now, but that's to tell you, why do we need to learn the language of research and how to critically appraise what we read? Because of all what we read, there are only few articles that are judged clinically relevant and valid to be applied. So, and like, how are we gonna know which one do we trust or which one is more valid or which one is more accurate? So here comes the difference between us and patients or patient relatives. Nowadays, I always, when I teach in medical school, I was like, you guys are really, really facing a trouble that we didn't face in the older days. Nowadays, the patients, they come to the clinic, they already read something. Maybe they are so educated that not only they read a magazine or websites, they read articles. So how are you different from them? Yes, experience comes in one of the major important differences between us and patients. But then we have to be equipped to answer them. Like, for example, they read something from the website or internet or maybe from not a very common or not very prestigious journal, and they're coming to discuss the results with us. So how are we going to answer them? We have to be updated. We have to know what's the problem with that paper. What's the problem with that management that they are offering or telling us. So there are so many barriers for us to apply the evidence-based healthcare. I'm going to mention some of them, but I'm sure everyone has his or her own barrier. So maybe time, of course, time. I mean, we will never get out of this. We always have a problem of time. Inability to access research. How many times we put it in PubMed or evidence-based or something, and then we want to access that article and we can't. Our institution does not allow us to access that paper. Or, again, I read the paper and I don't understand anything. Or, okay, I read the paper, but I'm not sure. What does Dr. Heidi means by critical appraisal? Like, how am I going to appraise this article and believe it or not? The other thing, even if you read the article, you attended a conference. Nowadays, I mean, if you attended really an abroad or outside or international conferences, they don't present topics. Never. They don't present topics. They present their own research work. They present their own papers. They don't present topics. Presenting topics is old-fashioned. Nobody talk about topics, causes, risk factors, what is the research done. No, no, no. Everyone should present his or her own topic. I wish we are one of those one day. So okay, we attended that conference and the speaker convinced us to, with whatever intervention or he or she are presenting, but we can't make changes. We are an institution that we have no power to make changes. So what's the point? Why do I read? No, we have to read. One day we will be able to apply what we read. Now, again, I'm sure we've changed. I'm sure if we are convinced, we can convince others. Yeah, it takes a lot of work, but we can. I'm sure if you look around you, many, many things. I don't know about the young ones, the younger ones who will appreciate that. But for the middle age and older ones like us, we appreciate the difference that is taking place from past years to now in terms of applying what we read in our practice. But we have to convince our idara, you know, we need this. So we need this. Give me the evidence. Okay. And that's it. So let's go back to learning the language. So having said that we need to learn how to read a paper and we need to know whether we apply it or not, there's always a balance between that and knowledge and experience. I mean, sometimes whatever we read, someone who has years and years of experience and it's working for him or her, cannot be convinced with whatever research is taking place. So sometimes experience can go over evidence. It needs experience. It needs years and years of practice to be able to say that. Okay, so let's start. So I'm not sure if I've presented this before, but for any research, we ask a question. If you remember, there is a question, right? And in order to answer this question, we use a systematic process to come up with a valid answer to that question. So what is that systematic process? It's the same way for critical appraisal. Whatever process you use to conduct your research, starting from the study question, starting from the aim, going to the method, statistical analysis, all of that systematic process of running or conducting a research is the same as the systematic process of appraising any paper. So same thing. It's how do we go systematically to review the paper's relevance, validity, and like, what do I mean by validity and results to specific situation? So you have to know what you're reading. Starting, I mean, we're going to come now to the process of how do we critically appraise. Now, I'm not sure if in your institution you do critical appraisal or journal clubs. I hope we do, because that's, alhamdulillah, it's a requirement from every program that they have journal club session. So when we do journal club session, all residents and fellows, they know that at the end of presenting the paper, they have to come with critical appraisal. But how it's done? It's done by going into one of the websites, and then they choose, for example, criticizing a cohort study, criticizing a randomized control trial, criticizing a case control study. So when they do that, they just say, yes, no, done, not done. Am I right? Is that what you do? Is that what you do when you run a journal club in your institution? You just come up with an already made list of how to appraise certain study design, and then you just say yes, no, done, not done. Am I right? Is that what you do? I don't know. We don't have answers. But anyways, so that's what how it's usually done. But all those questions, I mean, if someone doesn't understand what I'm saying, please let me know, because that's very important in the critical appraisal lecture. So exactly, yes, okay, thank you. So all of those questions, yes, no, it's done basically based on what we're going to say now. So you have to know why are they asking those questions when we critically appraise a certain study design, and where to look for that question, not just yes and no. And there is a reason why they ask that specific question when they critically appraise a certain study design. And it's not done in one time or two times or three times. It's done so frequently to understand why are we asking these questions, or how to critically appraise a paper. And I hope you all agree and you're all convinced that we should learn, or we should practice critically appraising a paper, because in one topic, you might find 30 papers talking about the same topic. Hopefully, most of them will say the same thing, but most often, there will be a discrepancy between one paper and the other. So one paper say, oh, it does work. The other paper say, oh, it's not significant. So which one are you going to believe? Which one you're going to believe? So you have to have a background on what is the criteria that I should follow so that I can believe one article than the other, or I can apply the results of this article but not the other one. So that's what we want to do with critical appraisal. So now, and why do we critically appraise? Why do we need to do that? As I said, to know the best evidence. The best evidence is what we're going to apply. So believe it or not, that comes mainly from the methods and results section. I'm sure most of us will just go to the abstract, maybe they will read the method from the abstract, I don't know, but everyone will jump into the conclusion that is in the abstract. So it says it works. Oh, nice. It says it doesn't work. Oh, okay, we're not going to use it. But that's not what is it about. That's not what's going to take you to the best evidence. Most of what we do in critical appraisal, it's in the methods and results section. The sections that no one reads, especially methods. I'm sure, who reads methods section? Who reads it? Does anyone read methods section? But not in journal club. In journal club, of course, you will read it. But in general, when you read an article, does anyone pay attention or read what's in the method? Someone answered, or just let me read. Methodology, sometimes, with a smile. Yes, most of our critical appraisal comes from how that study is done. And how the study is done comes from the methods. That's the most important section that will feed our critical appraisal. Okay, so before we start, now critical appraisal, let's just say it's not a solid strength or a weakness. It's just a how do we gonna balance assessment of its the paper strength and its limitations. We don't say weakness, we say limitation. It's actually assessment of the methods, how the research is done. That's the most important part when we critically appraise a study or we want to apply its results or no. And it's actually, it's not, يعني it's, يعني شوفوا إحنا مثلا every day مثلا we نقوم الصباح نعمل الروتين الصباحي and then we go to work. They say that trying to critically appraise, I'm saying trying, okay? Trying to critically appraise and understand a paper should be done routine. يعني a healthcare professional, يعني you're not allowed to say, oh, I don't read papers. No, nowadays there are no books. Even medical students, والله, they don't read books. They read papers. So nowadays, ما في books, ما في حفظ. Nowadays, there is evidence. What are we going to do? So, critical appraisal, it's not an exact science. Maybe I will read a paper, like Heidi will read a paper, and I actually, the strength is overcome the limitations. Someone else read the same paper, but in his or her opinion, using a systematic methods of appraising it, the limitations outweigh the strength. That's fine. It's not an exact science. It's up. Now we're going to learn the element of critical appraisal, and it's up to the reader. So there is no right or wrong answer. It's just the way you read it. And you don't really, I mean, trust me, you don't need to be an expert researcher in order to critically appraise. You just need to learn the language. And many people can speak, and they don't know the proper language or the العربية الفصحى بس بتكلموا عادي معانا, you know what I mean? ف you don't really to be an expert researcher, but you can critically appraise. How? By attending many of these courses or conferences or listening to people in international conferences, how they talk and how they present their research. You will learn it. You don't need to do a master degree. Master degree will just make you able to like give a lecture like me now, but it will not stop you from being able to read a paper properly. So there is also a common mistake is that we can't say that every paper it's published, so it must be a perfect paper. No. We cannot say that. Every paper has bias. Remember, what's bias in our language? What is a bias? Now, you know valid is accurate. So what's bias? Please, because it's very important for what we're going to say next. تحيز لا قلنا لا 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 not accurate. عكس not accurate اللي هي ايش؟ error bias يعني error في مشكلة. طيب, so every paper has bias and it's up to the reader. Please, هذا هو والله critical appraisal. Every article has a bias. Every article, ما في article ما فيها bias, and it's up to the reader to decide the bias is strong enough or big enough to trash the paper. Where is it? It's, I think, the next slide. Yes, to trash the paper. Or I'm convinced that this bias will not change my judgment or my how I read this paper, and I'm gonna apply what's there, and you're gonna archive your paper in your references. So again and again and again, critical appraisal is not a science. Is how every reader read the paper based on the factors that we're going to mention now. You have to decide for yourself. It's Yeah, في البداية حيكون شكلها طلاسم. And what are we doing? دكتورة هايدي is talking يعني طلاسم. We don't know what she's saying. بس والله the more you do it, it's gonna be so easy. يعني the more you do it, the more you practice, the more you establish journal clubs in your institution, the more this will be easy for you. So let's start now. So how are we gonna start critical appraisal? Like we have a paper. Let's say we have a journal club today, and one of you is asked to present a certain paper, right? So the first thing you should pay attention to, and it's part of your critical appraisal, is which journal am I gonna pick? There is like when I did PubMed search, there are the same topic more or less, the same topic comes 10 times, 10 articles. So which article I'm gonna use? Which article I'm gonna use for my journal club? I can't present all 10. No way. So I'm gonna choose one. So which one are you gonna choose? The first thing that you should think about before choosing is which journal. And why is that? Does anyone know why is that? And for example, if you don't know which journal, so I don't know this, the journal of neonatology, which are the excellent journals or what are the prestigious journals. So how do I know? How do I know which, for example, we're just maybe beginners and we've never read an article before and we don't know what are, we only know books, we don't know journals. So how are we going to know which journal to choose? Does anyone have an idea? Try. Oh, I have some answers. Impact factor. Sure. So Shaima, what is the impact factor? That's one of the most important things. Yes. So what is the impact factor? Of course, you're going to go and put the name of the journal and impact factor. So there will be a number. So what does it mean, this number? Does anyone know? Citations per article. Yes. Not per article. Per articles published in that journal. Yani how much or how I don't know how to say it. Yani قد ايش score انه هذه الجورنال has been cited, the articles اللي فيها has been cited in other papers. كيف يحسبوها صراحة ما أعرف. طيب. ولكن that's the impact factor. So for example, an impact factor of 0.5 or 1, and then there is an impact factor of 5. So which one I'm gonna choose? Of course the 5. And why? Why is that? Because the writers or the researchers know that this journal, they're gonna cite articles from that journal. They know that that is a peer-reviewed journal. Peer-reviewed, yani أي paper تتنشر فيها لازم تكون peer reviewed, يعني لازم تمر على, يعني ما هي فلوس, it's not money, يعني ما بدفع فلوس عشان أنشر الارتيكل, it's peer reviewed, يعني لازم عندها peer reviewed ناس researcher, ناس يفهموا في الريسيرش, and they it's gonna يرسلوا لهم paper and then they put their comments. هذه هي peer reviewed. تمام. في other things, but هذه the most important thing. So when I wanna cite or when I wanna tell the reader that I read journal from this sorry, I read a paper from this journal, so they know that this journal has been cited so many times and it's well respected and prestigious. Okay. Now, having said that, for example, there is a journal called Seminar in Perinatology. Okay, for example, the impact factor, I can't remember the last impact factor of seminars in perinatology, but let's say the impact factor is 4. Okay, and then there is an impact factor of a journal like for archives in childhood and pediatrics. This, for example, its impact factor is 10. And the same topic, let's say it's a neonatology topic, let's say it's we found the same topic in this journal and this journal, one with an impact factor of 4 and one with an impact factor of 9. So which one are you gonna choose? Which article? أنا ما حقعد أقرأ الاثنين وأقرر. I have now to start with one. Which one I'm gonna start with? في أحد تاج الدين said متخصصون في هذا. No. So here comes the dilemma and here comes the experience with the journal. So as a neonatologist, أنا والله ما أعرف, أنا I don't know if all of who's attending here is a neonatologist, بس so Shaima is saying I will choose the article in the same specialty. Yeah, of course. يعني again, maybe we'll end up by going to the archives, but we'll start with a seminar in neonatology. Why do we go to archives and we have seminars in perinatology? So that's mainly neonatal articles. You know what I mean? طب دكتورة, why the impact factor here is 4 and the impact factor here is 9? طيب, الarchives of pediatric and childhood, بالله كم واحد بيقراها وكم واحد يبغى to cite from it؟ البيدياتريشن كلهم, لكن السيمينار in neonatology مين حيقرأها؟ مين will cite it؟ A neonatologist بس. So do you get what I'm doing؟ يعني البسط والمقام حق الكلام ده. Yes, the impact factor here is 4 and here is 9, but that doesn't mean إنه أنا I will take the archive article وحسيب السيمينار in perinatology article. I hope I'm clear of what I'm saying. Okay, shall I go on? Okay, so there we go. So we chose the journal. Then the next step, not the abstract. We're not going to read the abstract next. Okay, we're going to go على طول على الintroduction. خلاص, we chose the article. Ignore the abstract. Please ignore the abstract. طيب, we're going to go, احنا دحين critical appraisal, ما ينفع نقرأ الابستراكت. طيب, we're going to go immediately to the introduction. Now, في حاجة مهمة, we have to make it very clear. عشان, if we want to say that a paper is excellent, it has to be like a story. كيف يعني؟ لها مقدمة, لها نهاية, لها شيء في النص, and كل section فيها, it answers or تجاوب السكشن اللي قبله. يعني it's like watching a movie. ما ينفع الموفي ما يكون مترابط, فاهمين قصدي؟ اوكي, في حصل شيء في البداية وحصل شيء في النهاية, بس كله مترابط في النهاية يؤدي إلى شيء واحد. A story, يعني ما ينفع الستوري تشتت الواحد. And what am I reading? What do they need? ماني فاهمة إيش فيه. You know what I mean? Doesn't work like that. Every section has to answer the section above. Okay? So the introduction, يعني ليش كثير, أنا كثير ناس يقولوا إنه إحنا عرب, الأجانب they don't accept our articles, they reject all of our articles. لا والله يا جماعة, it depends on how it's written. Really, it depends how it's written. Usually, because we did not teach or we did not learn how the principles of running or conducting a research principles. يعني مو كده أي أحد يسوي research is a research. لازم يكون في principles. Remember the slide حق systematic way of conducting a research. برضو there's a systematic way of appraising a research. So an introduction, it has to tell you very specific lines that lead you to the purpose and aim. يعني أنا ما ينفع أروح أعرف and give a definition to the problem again, give causes to the problem again. أنا, why do I have to do that? I don't have to do that. خلاص, it's known. أنا, I'm giving an introduction. Why am I doing this research? So what's known about this? And where is the gap? Where is the gap in the information we know about this topic, for example? And that will lead us to, why are we doing this research? Why are we publishing this article? Okay? So that's important, actually, when you read and when you publish. So you read the introduction. That will take you immediately to the aim. The aim should tell you, why am I doing this research? What's the aim? زي البيكو. So البيكو population, yeah, but in a very summarized way. One important thing I forgot to mention before, oops, sorry, before the aim and purpose. بعد ما اخترنا الارتيكل, طبعا اخترناها based on ايش؟ Based on the journal, بس كمان based on the title, صح ولا لا؟ يعني it has to, من التايتل لازم احنا نعرف what are we gonna read. عشان كده بعض الجورنال, البرستيجيوس جورنالز, هاي امباكت فاكتور جورنالز, ما ينفع تكتب لها اي تايتل. You have to know from the title a lot of things about the topic or the paper you're gonna read. يعني ما حتقول لك ما حتقول ايش هي البيبر بالتفصيل, بس سبحان الله دائما البرستيجيوس جورنال لازم تديهم لازم تديهم تايتل يقول كثير عن what are we going to read. طيب, so that's what I was gonna say here. So the purpose and aim should be similar to the title. يعني ما ينفع التايتل في حتة والpurpose والaim في حتة تانية. What's this disconnection؟ الجواب يبان من عنوانه. يا سلام, بالضبط. I love it. طيب, so and where do we find this purpose and aim عادة؟ اللي يقرأ journal, اللي يقرأ papers, فين عادة هذه الaim والpurpose نلاقيها؟ عادة في ال end of the introduction. كل article فيها introduction or background, the last few lines, two or three lines, حيكون فيها الaim. هذا هو كده, هذا النظام. طيب, okay, so after we خلاص we made sure we are reading a very good article من هذه الجورنال إن شاء الله, and the purpose and aim matches with the title. يعني ما هم disconnected, they're all saying الجواب باين من عنوانه. طيب, so next على طول بعد الaim حيجي إيش؟ حيجي الميثود اللي كلنا we skip it. أنا تحين ما سكيبت, زمان كنت سكيبت طبعاً. ف we all skip the methods. It's complicated, we don't want to read it. خلاص, إيش الفايدة؟ كيف عملوا الستدي؟ أنا مالي, أنا خليني أروح للريزلت على طول, صح؟ وكده إحنا نسوي؟ ما ينفع يا جماعة. If you want to learn critical appraisal, the method is where you're going to appraise the article. So the most important, so there are many things في هذه الميثود. أول حاجة في الميثودز هي مين هم الـ population حقوننا, مين هم الـ participants حقوننا. So maybe الـ participants or population اللي اختاروها, they chose من البداية, إحنا قررنا خلاص, no, that's not the population I'm interested in. لا, خليني أسيب دي الارتيكل واروح أشوف لي واحدة تانية فيها الـ population اللي أنا أبغى أقرأ عنها. Is that what I'm saying? Like for example, إذا مثلا كان الارتيكل بتدرس اوكي مثلا infants less than 32 weeks مثلا. طيب, but هذول البوبوليشن حقانهم اختاروا بس مثلا ethnic group معين, يعني اختاروا بس مثلا احنا ايش عندنا, يعني مش هنتكلم عموما مش عندنا, اختاروا بس الافريكان امريكان مثلا. لا, انا هذه ما ابغى اقراها ابدا, انا ابغى اقرا كل الـ population. I'm not interested in a special or ethnic background, ethnic group. أنا بس بديكم يعني مثال بسيط. طيب, that's why knowing the population that the paper is talking about is very important. تمام؟ The other thing, how did they recruit the population? من فين جابوا الـ population هذه؟ Is it really represent, does it really, sorry, does it really represent ال actual population. احنا قلنا ال actual population is the whole population. طبعا no one can study the whole population of a city or of a country or of a region. دائما حيكون في sample that would represent a population of interest that you're interested in. So how did they recruit هذه population؟ هل هم اختاروا اللي موجود وبس, ولا هم راحوا لأذر area they recruit ولا how did they recruit this population and that's very very important because لما نتكلم عن البايس هيجي تحين البايس choosing your population من أكبر السورسز حقت حاجة اسمها selection bias. Selection bias you choose your population. So if you choose it wrong then خلاص من أول هذا غلط الموضوع. أنا ما أبغى هذه population. I'm not interested في هذه population. Okay. Then في نفس ال method section في نفس ال method section هيكون ال study design. ياما والله يا جماعة اللي بالذات اللي يقرأ من journals يعني ما هي كويسة ياما التايتل يقول شيء البيربس والايم يقول شيء يجي الستدي ديزاين واتس ذس از ذس ذا ستدي ديزاين they used to do this لا طبعا ما ينفع ابدا this is not it فاهمين قصدي حتقول ازاي لا هو كده والله هذا اللي بيحصل but we don't pay attention to these things and we take and we take things for granted انه تتذكروا لما قلت لكم every paper has a bias no yes of course every paper has an error and you decide how big is this error right so then is it important to know the study design yes to make sure بنكمل الحكاية مظبوط ان هما they chose the right study design okay now comes to هذا دحين أصعب حتة هي دي دحين اللي حتيجي طيب بعد كده خلصنا الـ aim خلصنا الـ population خلصنا الـ study design نيجي عاد لأهم أشياء الـ critical appraisal وهذه هي الـ role of chance في حاجة اسمها chance وفي حاجة اسمها bias بعدين للـ bias نعرف وحنتكلم عنه طب إيش chance هذه أول مرة نسمعها what is chance chance ترى is error it's again زي البايس البايس is error والchance is error طب ليه ما نحطهم كلهم مع بعض ليش الchance لحاله والبايس لحاله في أحد جاوب شيء خلينا تحمل الـ p-value دي الأشياء خلينا نفهم إيش الفرق الأساسي بين الchance والبايس الchance يا جماعة هي حاجة اللي هي يسموها random error random error هذه هي طيب كيف يعني؟ هديكم مثال أنا أحب دايما أعطيه ما أعرف إذا أحد سمعوا مني قبل كده طيب معلش سامحوني إذا ما أعرف إذا الكل هنا من جدة ولا في أحد من الرياض ولا بس أنا لازم أستخدم هذا المثال عشان هو اللي أنا متعودة عليه so let's say خليكم معايا كويس let's say في أحد researcher يبغى يسوي cross-sectional study you know cross-sectional study right ويبغى and he wants to know كم نسبة الاتحاديين والأهلاويين في جدة طيب اللي من جدة يعرف إيش يعني اتحادي وإيش يعني أهلاوي خلاص so let's say إنه someone knows the truth يعني في كده الطائر الأخضر في أحد يعرف حسب كل الـ population حق جدة وقال إنه في 50 اتحادي و50 أهلاوي في أحد يعرف الله أعلم كيف جات الموضوع معه خلاص وجاء هذا الريسيرشر وقف في الطريق خلاص وسوى كويشنير انت اتحادي اهلاوي انت اتحادي اهلاوي خلاص وجمع 100 باسنجرز وسالهم في ال 100 باسنجر هذول طلع في 60 اتحادي و40 اهلاوي بس ما كيف كده ما ينفع انا اعرف انه كل جدة 50 أهلاوي و50 اتحادي كيف هذه المية طلع منهم 60 اتحادي و40 أهلاوي كيف كده فايش المشكلة أو الببلش هذه هيموتون الأهلاويين أو الببلش رمية متحيز لا ما فيها تحيز لا ما هي بايس it's not a bias this is not bias no فكروا مظبوط لكل كلمة مكتوبة لها مغزى. Study consists of asking 100 pastors in which team they support. I got more answers. Chance, chance, chance. Yes, بالصدفة. طب كيف احنا نضبط هذه الصدفة؟ كيف نلزع على الأهلاويين مننا؟ كيف نضبط الريزلتس ونخليها more close to the accurate, to the truth, التروث اللي هي في أحد قال لنا إنه 50-50؟ طب كيف كده؟ كيف أضبطها أنا؟ يا سلام، خلاص كلكم تحين، اللي جاوبوا صح increase the sample size. بس لو زودنا السامبل سايز ل 1000 فور اكزامبل، اشوف انا حاطه السلايد ولا لا، لو احنا زودناها ل 1000، طيب حيطلع لنا الاتحادين اقل والاهلاويين اكثر. trust me، هذا اللي حيصير. all what you need to do is increase the sample size، لانه what happened by error is a chance. حظنا انه اللي مروا في هذاك الوقت مع الانترفيور ولا الريسيرشر مروا اكثر اتحاديين. It's a chance. طيب so عشان كده لكل study، طيب you have to calculate the sample size. طبعا احنا ما تكلمنا في calculation of the sample size because this is very complicated. انا صراحة ما اعرف اشرحها، لكن اعرف انه في النهاية في software calculated for us. طيب so it's not about representative sample, it's about a size of who you recruited for this study. عشان كده في الميثود سيكشن، يعني لو انتوا اللي يعرف يقرا article في الميثود سيكشن، دايما يكون فيها sample size and how they calculated their sample size. وليش بيسووا كده؟ ليش بيسووا كده في البريستيجيوس جورنال؟ عشان لو مثلا كده طلع 40 60، يقولوا للريدر ترى احنا سوينا calculation sample size، احنا ما مو كده اخذنا اي رقم، عشان نقول لهم للريدرز انه ال chance مرة قليل في هذه الارتيكل، لانه احنا سوينا sample size calculation. ف that's why في method section always always في حاجة اسمها sample size calculation، عشان هذه الحركة. طيب ف طيب let's say، لا خلينا قبل هذه هنا. طيب لا ما هذه سوري، انا بس ما سويتها مظبوط. دحين هذه قلنا انه احنا هنسميها random error. طيب انا فلنفرض مو كل الـ articles اتحاد واهلي وبرسنت، لا في articles فيها odds ratio, risk ratio, remember these things and effect measures. طيب والconfidence interval، انا ما عندي percent، ما اعرف يعني كيف اقرر، ما اعرف التروث ايش هي. طيب so where to assess for random error؟ اوكي قالوا لنا sample size، بس برضو انا ماني مقتنعة بالsample size هذه حقتهم. so where do I look؟ يعني اشوف ال risk of chance ولا risk of random error كثير ولا قليل؟ اروح لل p value وال confidence interval. كيف يعني هذا الكلام؟ طيب مثلا انا حقرا لانه ما في احد الحين يقرا معايا. هذه article في التايتل حقها Protective Association of Milk Intake and the Risk of Hip Fracture. يعني هذه الارتيكل بتدرس الميلك انتيك والهيب فراكشر. خلاص طيب اخذوا 830 من and women، عدد لا باس به 830. طبعا انا جبت لكم الابستراكت، بس احنا قلنا ما نقرا الابستراكت. طيب so let's go to the results. خلاص الريزلتس تقول high versus low intake، يعني بغض النظر هم اكيد they define ايش يعني high يعني low intake. طيب so مين يقدر يقول لي ايش يعني هذه high؟ يعني لو قارنا ال high versus low حيطلع ال risk ratio هذا. ايش يعني هذا ال risk ratio؟ ايش يعني 0.58؟ يعني سيبكم من insignificant، خلينا سيبكم من ال p value، خلينا في ال 0.58. إيش معناته؟ معناته إنه لما الواحد يشرب high milk the risk of osteo hip fracture sorry the risk of hip fracture is less، صح؟ ولكن 0.58 يعني less than 1، يعني less. طيب يعني كأنه بنقول إنه الميلك intake decrease الهيب fracture، صح؟ طيب بس شوفوا الـ p-value والـ confidence interval إيش الـ p-value والـ confidence interval. الـ confidence interval cross الـ 1 and no effect. Yes. والـ p-value 0.07 يعني أكثر من 0.05 يعني insignificant. يعني بالله أنا حروح أقول للناس don't drink milk، يعني ما له علاقة بالهيب فراكشر، ما حيظبط لكم العظام حقتكم كده. حقول معقول؟ هتقولي دكتورة طب هي كده طلعت البي فاليو، أنا إيش أسوي؟ كده طلع الكونفيدنس انترفال، أنت قلتي لنا إنه لو كروس 1 it's not significant ولو more than 0.05 it's not significant. طب إيش أسوي أنا الحين؟ Here comes the critical appraisal. طيب so 830 من women مش بطال ابدا، يعني it's a good number. الله اعلم كيف سووا ال sample size حقتهم، we have to read. طيب ولكن شوفوا بالله ال confidence interval. طيب pay attention. Remember I don't know if you remember if I said statistical significance does not mean clinical significance does not mean. طيب هل أنا already عندي risk ratio 0.58 already drinking milk decreased the hip fracture. طيب طلع insignificant بس شوفوا ال confidence interval crossing 1 بس شوفوا 1.06 يعني نقطة بس أكثر من 1. 0.07 يعني ما هي point مثلا 1 ولا 0.2، 0.07 يعني very close to being significant, very close. طيب ايش انا حقول لهدول ال ايش حقول لهدول ال authors ولا كيف حسوي critical appraisal؟ Am I gonna believe هذا الشيء و I work on it ولا am I gonna say لا 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 يمكن، لازم ايش؟ لازم يزودوا السامبل سايز حقتهم. لو زودوا السامبل سايز حقتهم I might get 0.3 to 0.9. تخيلوا لو 0.9 حتطلع significant بس عشانها 106 طلعت insignificant. يا سلام عليكم. Yes increase the sample size exactly. So when I see this I will go to the study design وأشوف كيف هم أصلاً حسبوا السامبل سايز هذه. طيب so بس I can't say oh it's not significant okay don't drink milk. لا I can't say that. فهمتوا علي؟ So that's why here in this we said a random error اللي هو role of chance اللي هو السامبل سايز نلاقيه فين؟ نلاقيه في ال p value وال confidence interval. لما يكون ال p-value وال confidence interval مرة قريب very close to the significant level just increase your sample size وحيظبط. You know what I mean? Is it clear? طيب let's take another example. So هنا enuresis comorbidity and obesity يعني ال association بين ال obesity وال enuresis. تمام؟ So, يقول لكم each increment of BMI score is associated with increased risk of enuresis. خلينا نشوف الـ odds ratio. هنا حسبوا الـ odds ratio. لقوا الـ odds ratio 2.1 معناته it does increase. So, الـ obese or BMI كل ما زادت كل ما زاد الـ enuresis. وإيش الـ confidence interval حقها؟ 1.4 to 3. عظيم. هذه very significant. شوفوا ال p-value كيف طلعت 0.08. طيب فهم ال 281 children شكلها it's a perfect sample size. فاهمين قصدي؟ يعني ومو لازم يعني مو لازم دايما انه عشان انه very close to the significance زودنا sample size حيتحسن. لا مو لازم. ما انتو how are you gonna tackle this if you are the writer not the reader? You just write justification for your sample size. If you are the reader, you have to decide their justification is valid or not. هتقولوا لي طب دكتور احنا ايش عرفنا السامبل سايز كيف تنحسب وكده. If you read a lot هتوصلوا لكيف هنعرف نسويها. تمام. طيب now let's go to another source of, خلاص هذه قلناها. طيب خلصنا الشانس، دحين الفاليديتي. فاليديتي يعني accurate، خلاص. طيب now if you read any paper في two types of validity، في ال internal validity وفي ال external validity. الحين حنقول ايش يعني ال internal validity، انه reading the methods, reading how it's done, reading the statistical analysis and the results, you have to decide is this paper internally valid، يعني هل هذه البيبر خلاص ما فيها chance ولا فيها bias ولا فيها حاجة إنه أنا I will consider it as valid and I'm gonna apply it. هذه اسمها internal validity. طيب so ال internal validity تجي من two things. You have to decide how much bias is does this paper have and is there any confounding that they did not account for or not. معلش طلاسم شوية بس إن شاء الله حنفهم. In terms of bias في مرة كثير types of bias، مرة كثير، يعني أنا ما أعرف إلا يمكن ربع هذه ال biases. طيب ولكن من أهم أنواع ال bias اللي يعني يمكن تسمعوها وتقرأوها كثير هي هذه ال bias. Selection زي ما قلنا selection bias، إنه did they account for like who are the population they selected، هل اختاروا الناس اللي أصلا عندهم هذا الديزيز كثير؟ طب ما خلاص ما حيطلع في association مع أي exposure، هل حيطلع إنه اختاروا هدول الناس من مكان أصلا ما عمره يجي فيه هذا الديزيز؟ طب ما حيطلع ال association very low لأنه يعني ما هي representative of your population. طيب فهذه اسمها selection bias. information bias مثلا احنا بندرس ال effect of medication على blood pressure، ولقينا ال blood pressure في الناس اللي أخذوا treatment is measured differently من الناس اللي ما أخذوا treatment. طيب يعني وبعدين معناه احنا كل ال information اللي حتطلع ما هي مظبوطة. طيب أو مثلا احنا بناخد من الـ records information، وهذه الـ information لقينا إنها ما بتنكتب بنفس الطريقة في كل progress note ولا في كل patient. ليه؟ لأنه مثلا هنا بيكتبوها مثلا كان medical student، تتغير وصار يكتبوها specialist. طيب ما حيكتبوها بطريقة مختلفة. ف and that's why الـ method section، هذا اللي عشان كده تعرفوا ما قلت لكم انه الناس تقول انه الجورنالز ما تقبل البيبرز من البلاد العربية، لا ابدا. It's just because it's not written properly. واهم section ما بنكتب properly هو الميثود، انه كيف جبنا البوبوليشن، how did we measure the exposure، how did we measure the outcome، define this define this define this. خلاص ما حد يقدر يقول إنه غلط as long as you write how you did it and how it's done. طيب attrition bias هذه عادة في ال cohort studies. ال cohort studies إحنا إيش قلنا cohort؟ cohort يعني population based on their exposure، نجمعهم و follow the outcome over time. طيب أنا هذا it depends، أنا ال outcome حقي يطلع بعد قد إيش؟ هل هو outcome common، هل هو outcome rare؟ عشان يطلع هنقعد 10 سنين وما طلع ال outcome أكيد ح I will lose some of my population. فهذه اللي اسمها attrition bias. طيب اللي هي loss of follow up. طيب فهذه مرة مهمة. You have to decide اللي سابوا ال study يمكن 20%، هل هذا good percentage for you to say oh no 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 attrition percent is too much, I'm not gonna read this. Or, oh no, 20% is okay, I will continue reading the article. طيب؟ Now, remember الاتحاد والأهلي؟ طيب ممكن بس نبغى نعمل شيء تاني. Let's say نفس الريسيرشر راح أخذ جمع ألف population. طيب زي هذاك الثاني لما نزود السامبل سايز حقته، وراح هنا في هذا الشارع ومر الناس، مرور الناس بيسألهم انت اتحادي اهلي اتحادي اهلي، تعتقدوا ايش حيطلع معه؟ ايش حيطلع مع البرسنت حق الاتحادي والاهلي؟ تعتقدوا تنبؤات، اخذ ألف باسنجر، ايش تعتقدوا؟ طلع معاه 70% اتحادي و30% اهلي. ليه؟ اوكي تعالوا نزود السامبل سايز. تبغوا تزودوا السامبل سايز؟ خلاهم 2000، خلاهم 2000 برضو نفس الشيء، جاله 72 اتحادي والباقي اهلاوية. زيادة العدد ما فادوا بشيء، الاتحاد يكسب كل مرة إن شاء الله يا رب. بس مكان منطقة سكن الاتحاديين، يا سلام. طيب so هذه ما ينفع نقول chance، this is not chance, this is bias. لو عدناها مليون مرة، لو زودنا 10,000 حيطلع الاتحاديين أكثر من الأهلاويين، ما حيطلع. طيب فهي هذه نفسها، الحين هيجينا الكلام، هذه حتتحسن لانه احنا نزود السامبل سايز؟ ابدا ابدا ما حتتحسن ابدا. طب كيف نحسنها؟ كيف نحسن البرسنتج ونكون اقرب الى الاكيوريت، الى التروث؟ تتذكروا قلنا التروث 50-50؟ طيب ايش لازم نسوي عشان نحسنها؟ change the place exactly. لازم نغير الديزاين كله. And it's exactly with any study design you do. عشان كده لما نبدأ نقرر إيش نسوي في أي study، هذا طبعا reading it is different from conducting it. طيب لازم نسأل expert، يا جماعة هذه إيش حيكون فيها مشكلة؟ ما ينفع مثلا واحد يسوي research على kidney injury وهو ما معاه nephrologist في الموضوع، ما ينفع. فاهمين قصدي؟ ما ينفع تروح تقرا بيبر عشان تفلس من الرياض. من الرياض ما حيطلع لا في ولا واحد اهلاوي ولا اتحادي. طيب so اذا ما حسنا من الديزاين من قبل ما نبدا الستدي، it will never change. البايس اللي فيها it will never change. And that's exactly how you do it when you read the paper. When you read the paper you decide كيف اتعملت، هذا اللي عملوه مسموح ولا مش مسموح. طيب هل انت في نظرك من اكسبرت، ما انت مع كل واحد حيقرا البيبر اللي هو يبغى يقراها في السبيشالتي حقته، فهو الاكسبرت في السبيشالتي حقته. طيب ساعتها يقدر يقول انه هذه فيها بايس كبير ولا لا. اما someone who's not expert ايش عرفه انه هذا الشيء اللي بيصير صح ولا غلط؟ تمام. طيب so there's no way to control the bias, the only way is to avoid it. طيب فهذا difference بين البايس والchance. So البايس it will always happen no matter what you do. الchance ممكن تحسنه بالsample size. المكان ما نشوف فين السيستماتيك error أو البايس، عادة تشوف other papers إيش سوت وتقارنها. مكان ما نشوف الchance عادة ال p value وال confidence interval. طيب نجي دحين للconfounding. So في ناس يسموا البايس confounding والconfounding bias، بس في ناس يفصلوهم عن بعض، يقول لك لا bias is a bias، confounding نقدر نضبطه، نقدر نضبطه. البايس ما البايس ما نقدر نضبطه أبدا، لازم نغير الديزاين كله. طيب هديكم مثال عشان تعرفوا. دايما دايما تيجي سيرة الكونفاوندرز، ودايما دايما الناس تجتهد في تعريف الكونفاوندرز، وهي you just need to know what is it so that you know how to read it. طيب ففلنفرض انه مو فلنفرض هو هذا اللي صار، انه someone found that بيدرس ال outcome حق healthy heart outcome، يعني ايش اللي يخلي ال heart healthy، ولقى انه ال carrot juice طيب does improve ال heart outcomes كده، هم لقوها كده. طيب في نفس الوقت في احد درس ال exercise، ومعروف انه الناس اللي تشرب carrot juice كثير تسوي exercise كثير. طيب لكن برضو اللي تسوي exercise كثير عندها good healthy heart outcome، صح ولا لا؟ so ال exercise هنا له علاقة بال exposure وله علاقة بال outcome، فاهمين قصدي ولا لا؟ يعني معروف من غير الكاروت جوس، من غير الكاروت جوس الناس اللي سووا exercise they have better health outcome، خلاص؟ من غير ال heart outcome معروف انه الناس اللي تشرب جوس كثير كده بطبيعتها رياضية كده، في research كده سوا. طيب مين ال confounder هنا؟ في واحد confounder، مين ال confounder؟ مين اللي ممكن يخرب العلاقة؟ معروفة يعني واضحة ال exercise. yes لأنه لو أنا بدرس ال carrot juice مع ال healthy art without taking consideration of، يعني مثلا أنا حدرس ال carrot juice وال healthy heart outcome بس ما فصل carrot juice drinkers مين هدول اللي منهم عندهم يسووا exercise ومين اللي ما يسووا exercise، لو ما فصلتهم معناته أنا بمحي هذه العلاقة حقت ال effect of exercise، وحتطلع ال result confounded by the exercise. كيف يعني؟ خلينا ناخذ مثال ثاني. طيب طبعا هذا المثال المعروف دائما إنه ال coffee drinking وال heart disease، خلاص؟ في أحد درس ال coffee drinking وقال إنها تزود الـ heart disease، والـ odds ratio 3 والـ confidence interval let's say significant. طيب كده في أحد درس هذه الدراسة، خلاص؟ so لكن في أحد ذكي قال لا يا جماعة لازم ندور على الـ confounders عشان نثبت إنه الـ coffee drinking really does affect heart disease من غير ما يكون في confounders في العلاقة هذه. فراح أحد إيش سوى؟ قسم الناس حقون الكافي درينكينج، قسمهم إلى ناس smokers و non smokers، هم كلهم coffee drinkers كلهم، بس قسمهم ل smokers و non smokers. ليه أخذ ال smoking into consideration؟ لأنه معروف بالريسيرش، عشان كده يعني لازم الواحد يكون مطلع على الريسيرش قبل ما يقرر هذه البيبر فيها بايس كثير ولا لا. فمعروف انه السموكينج يزود الهارت ديزيز، صح ولا لا؟ فلما نقسموهم سموكرز ونون سموكرز، طيب ودرسوا علاقة الكافي درينكينج بالهارت ديزيز في كل تراتا او في كل يعني مجموعة، طيب لقوا ما في effect of coffee drinking على الهارت ديزيز في كل واحدة. هذا معناته ايش؟ معناته انه السموكينج did confound العلاقة بين الكافي درينكينج والهارت ديزيز، وشكلها كلها because of smoking ما له علاقة الكافي درينكينج. طيب فهذه هي الكونفاوندر. طبعا طبعا لو ما احد يعرف ايش ال يعني ايش هي الكونفاوندرز اللي ممكن تخرب هذه العلاقة، حيقرأ البيبر وهو ما هو عارف يعني how to comment on it، عشان كده كل واحد يقرأ البيبر اللي في اختصاصه، فاهمين علي؟ فهذه حكاية الكونفاوندرز. so الكونفاوندرز مش زي البايس. البايس قلنا ما يتحسن، لازم تتغير الستدي ديزاين كلها عشان يتحسن، لكن الكونفاوندينج ممكن أحد to account for it أو تاخده في عين الاعتبار، يا إما في study design يا إما بال statistical test. طبعا هذا حيتدخل فروع أخرى، ولكن في الستدي ديزاين انا for example ما ابغى السموكرز، ما ابغى ادخل السموكينج في الموضوع، ابغى بس ادرس الكوفي والهارت ديزيز. فممكن اشيل كل السموكرز من الستدي سامبل حقتي، هذه اللي يسموها ريستريكشن، خلاص انا ما ابغى اي سموكر عندي. طيب، او كل واحد في الكوفي درينكر سموكر اجيب له واحد نو كوفي درينكر سموكر، هذه اللي يسموها ماتشنج، يعني اخليهم شبه بعض في السموكينج، مختلفين بس في الكوفي درينكينج. يعني انا بس all what I'm saying انه there is a way to deal with confounders، يا اما في study design او في statistics. statistics يا اما نسوي stratification زي اللي سويناها كده، قسمناهم smokers non smokers، او نسوي حاجة اسمها regression، يعني اللي بيعرف عنها ممكن نقوله بعدين. بس يعني again they are study they are statistical tests that take care of confounders، تشيلها من الحسبة بحيث يكون بس ال exposure وال outcome هم اللي في الطريق. طيب let's read this one، أنا حقرا لأنه أكيد ما so هذه relationship between objectively measured physical activity and vascular structure، يعني مين ال exposure physical activity، مين ال outcome ال vascular structure. خلاص ما أعرف والله إيش في الفاسكولار ستراكشر، يعني شوفوا كويسة مو كويسة I don't know. طيب على طول على طول نروح لل results، إيش يكتبوا إيش كاتبين هنا. يعني ذات أنا بقول لكم كيف هم يكتبوا هذه الأشياء، إحنا قلنا في confounders أكيد كثير في هذه الحكاية، فهم إيش كتبوا. In multiple regression analysis, the regression analysis is a way of taking care of confounders. هذا كله سوفت وير، يعني مو انتوا تسووه، بس تدخلوا الفاريبل في السوفت وير وهو يسويها. So in multiple regression analysis after adjusting for confounding factors، ما هي هذه كده regression adjust، يعني يشيلوا ال effect of كل ال confounders ويبقى بس ال exposure وال outcome. خلاص فقالوا again in multiple regression analysis after adjusting for confounders the inverse association were maintained، يعني whatever association they found لسه موجودة، يعني وجود ال confounders هذول ما غير في نتيجة ال result ال paper. طيب so يعني that's where we find confounders. شوفوا الثانية هذه risk factors for ventilator associated events case control. هدول ايش سووا من البداية عملوا matching، ما استنوا يعملوا regression، عملوا matching من البداية. فقالوا 110 patients with ventilator associated conditions were matched to 110 controls، يعني controls without ventilator associated conditions. فهم already they match them together، but they match them for what؟ They match them for age, sex, ICU type, whatever. فهذه الأشياء اللي they match for هي المفروض إنه اللي تعتبر confounders، اللي حتأثر على ال outcome وليها علاقة بال exposure. طيب معلش حتى لو طلعت يعني اسمنا بنتعلم بس ال vocabulary شوية شوية، تمام؟ طيب let's say خلاص احنا قررنا ايش الشانس حق حق هذا البيبر، وعرفنا انها internally valid لانه ما في bias كتير والconfounders ما في. طيب خلاص خلصنا الinternal validity، حيجي للexternal validity. Am I gonna apply the results to my patients؟ هذا يعتمد على ايه؟ يعتمد على due weight. Remember the due weight اللي تكلمنا فيها؟ So you decide، هل population نفس population حقتنا؟ هل ال intervention ولا ال exposure ده applicable، يعني نقدر نسويه في اليونت حقتنا؟ هل ال outcome of interest هذا احنا اصلا متخوفين منه وعندنا كتير، ولا اصلا ما عمرنا سمعنا فيه؟ So that's when it comes to external validity. طيب so when you have an association في any, when you read a paper with any association, so دايما نسأل نفسنا هل هذه الاسوسيشن شكلها حقيقي ولا فيها بايس، هل شكلها حقيقي ولا فيها كومفاوندرز ما adjust for، هل ممكن يكون فيها chance أو يعني random error وهم ال sample size حقتهم صغيرة عشان كده ما وصلنا، هل لا causal، سيبوكم من causal، هل am I gonna apply and make guidelines and judgment now or I'm gonna read another article، what am I gonna do؟ طيب so في ال critical appraisal comes to the end now. في ال critical appraisal أهم حاجة تشوفوا هنا do و do not، إيش الأشياء اللي نحتاج نسويها ونحتاج إنه we have to avoid. طيب please please معلش حتى لو صعب read the method section، هتتعلموا يعني ال prestigious journal أصلا تحتم على ال author إنه يكتب detailed method، كيف سووا وكيف عملوا وكيف ليه هم بيحتموا عليهم كده، عشان ال replication. Replication means oh هذه study اتعملت مرة ممتازة في هذه ال population بس هذاك ال author يبغى يعملها في other population، so when they read your method they can replicate what you did، وهذا it's very okay. طبعا أنا عندي population مختلفة، again part of the methods كمان ال study design وإحنا إيش بنسوي، إيش هي الانكلوجن والإكسكلوجن، are they the same as my population ولا they different. طيب وبايس، كيف عارف إنه في بايس ولا لا، you have to read a lot. طيب فين أنا حلاقي هذا الكلام في البيبر، هل البيبر تساعدني إنه أنا أفهمها وأعرف how to critically appraise it وأفهم إيش ال strength وال limitation حقتها؟ yes ال paper for prestigious journal لازم في نهاية ال discussion لازم يكتبوا section اسمه strength and limitation. طيب إيش what was done good in this paper and what where is the source of bias ولا confounding ولا كده. فتخيلوا اللي يقرأ هذا ال section اللي هو في آخر ال discussion كأنه بيتعلم epidemiology، كأنه بيتعلم critical appraisal، لأنه المجلة تحتم على الـ writer ولا على الـ author إنه لازم يكتبوا الـ strengths والـ limitations حقتهم. طيب and regardless of you decided you it's a good or bad article read the strengths والـ limitations عشان تعودنا how to critically appraise and what are the important points in appraisal. تمام now in the do not طيب يعني please don't read the abstract and the conclusion and yes it's right وخلاص please don't do that. طيب ولا don't assume هذه قلناها don't assume that every result or every nature of any article is right or it's valid or it we can use it. No you have to test it once and twice and thrice in order to know you have to know فيها bias ما فيها bias فيها chance يعني you have to read more before you apply what it's been done. So how do you do and do not and then I think I put this before don't be confused والله it's صراحة أنا أقول إنه it depends on how much you care for your patient لأنه إذا في شيء جديد طلع and you want to apply it you have to know ال evidence هذا ways to apply or not. إذا أنتم ما you don't want to read article and you don't want to critically appraise خلاص go to the conferences go to conference that discuss research. طيب ف you don't have to agree or disagree you're just learning the language again you don't have to agree and disagree you do your own بس هي كده يعني هو كده reading a paper or appraising a paper It's not a science. Remember when we said that? ما في صح وغلط. مو لازم اثنين يتفقوا على نفس الشيء. بس اللي they speak the same language fluently زي بعض هيقولوا نفس الشيء. I hope I'm clear on that. طيب. So خلاص احنا خلصنا صراحة. If you have any question please do. it's not everything about critical appraisal. I just gave you the most important points. And if you go, please, please, Allah yarda alaykum, whoever does journal club, please اقرأوا هذه التشيك ليست اللي انتم تسووها. ترى صدقوني حتلاقوها نفس هذا الكلام بس مكتوبة بصيغة أسئلة. You know what I mean؟ ما هي مكتوبة بصيغة إنه you critically appraise، مكتوبة بس بصيغة أسئلة وكل واحد هو وفهمه. بس if you read it now after this lecture، أنا متأكدة حتى لو مو 100%، let's say 50 إلى 60%، نظرتهم للquestion شوية حتتغير، تمام؟ وحتعرفوا ليش هم بيسألوا هذه الأسئلة في التشيك ليست هذه. Any question؟ أنا هذا آخر لكتشر معاكم. Really really I'm honest، أنا ما جاني أي إيميل، but whoever wants to ask any question I can answer it by email. خذوا الإيميل حقي and send me an email. إذا ما جاوبت في نفس اليوم sure I will answer sometime within a week إن شاء الله. الله يكرمكم. Thank
دكتورة،
you
there is a
for
question
coming.
here written in the chart.
Sure, yes.
Usually we use it for a critical appraisal of article. They are asking what do you think
Yeah.
about it?
ما هذا اللي أنا قلته. ما في special website ل how to critically appraise، وعادة هي checklist yes no yes no yes no، عادة هي كده. طيب so بس يعني اللي كتبها واللي عملوها بيفهموا هذا الكلام، فإحنا عادي يعني الترينيز والدكاترة كلهم بيعرفوا يقولوا yes no بس كده، مش based on understanding why are they asking these questions. يعني انت هل هم ما يعرفش يعني ال questions very كده، ما هي details، ما تقول why are we asking these questions، عشان to rule out the bias, the chance, the error, the selection bias, the size, يعني كلها ترى تصب في هذا الكلام بس بطريقة question. إيش رأيي فيها؟ للأسف if you're running a journal club بالطريقة الصح okay use it، use the checklist، بس لازم نناقش ال checklist ليش، why yes why no، why yes why no. That's how we learn why يعني how do we critically appraise and that's how we're gonna decide are we gonna apply the results or no. طيب اما yes no yes no ما حتكفي ان احنا نفهم الارتيكل. What do you recommend for reading more about critical appraisal؟ للامانه reading alone will not help you. You have to be in a group, in a group who is interested and discuss. يعني reading حيكون زي كأننا بنقرا causes و outcome يعني كده. طيب ما حيكون، لأنه زي ما قلنا it's not an exact science. حيقعدوا they define things for you, they give you the reason، بس ما حينفع، لازم you apply it. حقيقي أنا لما اتعلمت ال critical appraisal أوكي عرفت كل هذا الكلام، بس والله عمري ما تعلمت إلا لما قعدنا نسوي يمكن 4 5 articles critical appraisal عشان أفهم إيش يعني critical appraisal. ومو لازم يكون في نفس، ترى اللي يسوي critical appraisal للأمانة مو لازم يكون في نفس التخصص حقه، في نفس التخصص حقه it will make it easier. طيب اللي ما يكون في نفس التخصص حقه حيكون مشكلة. ليه؟ لأنه حيقول لك طيب أنا إيش عرفني هذا البايس measurement bias، أنا إيش عرفني how it's measured أصلاً. طيب اللي ما يكون في التخصص حقه حيقول بس يعني هي selection bias، بس كيف selection bias، انا ما اعرف ايش هي اصلا، الاصل population حقتهم كيف شكلها. ف yeah you can make general critical appraisal on topics you don't know but usually it should be something you are expert in عشان تقدر تسوي او تقدري تسوي critical appraisal. Again احنا ما بنعمل critical appraisal عشان هو واجب او هو، احنا بنعمله عشان ال patient care، نبغى نعرف what's the best evidence عشان to apply what's there. فأحسن شيء انه نسوي critical appraisal نحضر discussion كثير، ما أعرف شو يتسوى للأمانة، يعني I have no idea where it's done، بس كل مستشفى لازم تعرف مين اللي يفهم في الكريتيكال ابريزل ويكون معاها مرة في الشهر، بس مرة في الشهر. أي سؤال؟ Any question please. كيف حالك يا دكتور محمد عبد الله؟ Any question? Please, can you share my email with the attendees? Maybe someone has a question and they will remember later to ask.
أكيد
It's a great
دكتورة.
interest for the baby. Yes. No. A wee checklist. Yeah. It's checklist عشان to draw attention of the reader to where you have to find this these critical appraisal points. بس للأسف يعني لازم الواحد يعرف إيش الـ background حق هذه الـ questions اللي بيسألوها في الـ checklist. طيب ف I'm ready to answer. والله إن شاء الله، يعني أنا زي ما قلت لكم إذا I did not answer the same day it will take إن شاء الله not more than a week to answer بإذن الله any question you have. And I'm sorry I don't have a reference because for me to come up with this, يعني it took me 2 years and many many references, بس أكتر شيء استفدت منه هو إني أنا أتكلم مع الدكاترة من جد والله، أو إني أتكلم مع اللي درسوني كثير، لأنه هو كله applied، ما اختبرونا list و define وده الكلام، ما في، it's all papers و critically appraised زي كده. أي سؤال؟ طيب شكرا جزيلا لاستماعكم وشكرا جزيلا إنكم معانا الثلاثة lectures، وإن شاء الله بالتوفيق للجميع و happy reading يسموها للجميع. شكرا.
يعطيك ألف عافية دكتورة، شكرا لك ويعطيك العافية إن شاء الله، في أمان الله.
في أمان.
شكرا جزيلا دكتورة، يعطيك العافية. Thank you all.